Hello, Reef friends. Welcome back to Craft Aquatic. I'm Matt G. In the spirit of the season, which is currently the end of October, I thought it might be fun to present you with a fresh top 10 list, or maybe I should call this a bottom 10 list, since I will be offering some of my most useful suggestions when it comes to the 10 scariest things having to do with our reef aquariums. If you haven't already, please take a moment to hit the thumbs up and subscribe to Craft Aquatic so we can make many more videos like this. Enjoy! A scary time for fish as much as it is for a child with an active imagination. As you have likely noticed in your reef system, no matter what kind of fish you keep, they all need a place to feel comfortable, especially when the lights start to go out. This is totally natural behavior for an animal that spends its life on a reef full of predators, many of which prefer to hunt at night. One of the best things you can do to ensure your fish are healthy, parasite-free, especially when first introducing them, is to make sure they have plenty of caves, nooks, crannies, overhangs, places to go. Really, each fish should have its own area to call home at night, and if they don't, they probably will not survive in your system. Most of our aquariums do not have active predators stalking our fish day or night, but you'll still want that full net coverage and or a canopy to keep fish from jumping out when they get spooked, which happens more often than you think. Number two are the powerful pumps we use to push water around in our aquariums. These tungies have really strong magnets, so you don't have to worry about the pump itself dropping onto the substrate, which can cause all sorts of issues. Pump design is key. You want your pumps to push plenty of water widely distributed while keeping the fish and invertebrates in your system from being sucked in. This gyre pump is great for surface agitation, but it is difficult to clean, and after several years of owning it, the company no longer offers parts or support, which basically makes it useless eventually to me, so consider that when buying an expensive pump. As mentioned before, these pumps can push a ton of water, and they will cause massive amounts of surface agitation, which is great for oxygen in the water. Some of the fish in your system will be used to this sort of flow and current in your tank, but others, like these saltwater mollies, are weaker swimmers. So you really have to be careful when introducing them into the tank. You'll want to dial down your controllers as much as possible and just slowly bring them up over time to allow the new fish to acclimate to your system. Again, this goes with scary thing number one, where you don't want your fish to jump out. And there are some pumps that are awesome, great companies design them, but they suck fish into the back. I'm just gonna say it like this Nero 5. So people have come up with these guards you can put on, and now the company sells the pump with a guard. You'll definitely want to use that. On the list at number three are the heaters we use in our aquarium. No big surprise, they come with these cheap fiddly thermostats built in. It's amazing they work at all, but they will get stuck. So you want to use separate controllers. Separate controllers, do it. This is really important. I don't currently have a whole system controller, so I use this Inkbird unit to run my fan and my heater, and I have a redundant security cutoff by Auto Aqua that will cut all the heat in my system if anything goes wrong. On top of it, I always make sure to have a backup controller for my heating and cooling so that I can quickly swap it out if anything goes wrong. I find what works best is to keep the two titanium heaters, 300 watts each, in the overflows while keeping the probes in the sump. This allows for even heat distribution, but when I pause the system for feeding, I have to turn the heaters off. Whenever I'm doing something critical with the tank, like turning the heat off, that is not typical, I'll put something up in an area that annoys me to remind me to turn that heat or whatever it is back on. At number four, arguably one of the absolute worst things that could happen to your system is a leak. A leak could be horrible depending on where you have your aquarium. In the basement, maybe not so bad, but on our wood floors, yes. So we use all Schedule 80 plumbing and unions and valves and things that can be easily disassembled if there is such a leak. Things that can be replaced. Our sump can hold extra water, and we use check valves whenever practical and possible, like this gate valve, so that backflow is not an issue in a system like the Rack and Rubble, which incorporates two entire aquariums coming back into one sump. You want to keep your return over the surface of the water, if possible, or near the surface, so that it does not cause back siphon to fill that sump. And always have some sort of a water alarm around all your tanks. Here I'm showing the box that holds the electronics in the waterproof tub that can also hold a leak. The electronics are suspended above any area where water can collect. And between our main tank stand and wood floors, we keep a polycarbonate mat, which has protected our tank on numerous occasions from drips and spills. There's nothing that tests your reef preparedness like a power outage, and there are several ways to deal with this. One of the easiest is just to have a backup battery ready to come on, power one of your pumps. You can get these battery-powered air pumps for very cheap. They're like $20 a piece. They'll run for hours on D-cells and come on when the AC cuts. A Wi-Fi controller is nice for alerting you when the power goes out, but if you don't have one, just employ one of the smart devices already in your home. One of the best insurances you can have is a generator dedicated to your reef system. Just make sure it's gassed up, ready to go whenever you need it. One of my favorite tips in this video, mark where that generator needs to be plugged in. It will help you and your tank sitter in a stressful situation. With proper ventilation and care, a kerosene heater can heat the entire room that your tank is in, keeping you and your tank warm during a power outage. And number six on the list, babies. Okay, maybe not just babies, but young kids who aren't used to being around a reef tank don't understand how delicate it is. I have this one simple solution. No, really, I'm just kidding. I love watching kids experience the reef tank. It is something fascinating to them. You just gotta make it safe. So I've used this twine trick in the past where I just keep the doors a little more secure. It keeps little hands out, as does just putting a giant heavy plant in front of the doors. But really in this hobby, an ounce of prevention is worth like 13 pounds of salt. So just move all those chemicals out of low down cupboards. Move your pennies and coins up high so they can't be dropped into the sump, and everything will be good, because really the tank's up pretty high, so the only thing you have to worry about is what's reachable down low. When it comes to overfeeding, the trick is to not feed any more than your system needs. Yes, that sounds simple, but it is really all there is to it. If you're having all sorts of nutrient issues, back off on the feeding. Usually that's gonna help move you in the right direction. For me, prepared foods work the best. I find a high quality flake that is nutrient dense with as few fillers as possible. I can swish a little pinch of it around in the water column, get them floating around in a way where they're evenly distributed throughout different flake sizes. I'll work for the different mouth sizes of all the fish in the tank. They all get a little piece. They don't need much because it is prepared food that is jam-packed with nutrients. And when you have tricky feeders like a marine betta, especially when you first introduce them, you want to pay particular attention to shifting nutrient levels as you try to get that fish to eat. You'd be surprised how little decisions can move your nutrients in the wrong direction. The other thing I like about feeding prepared foods, you can throw it in a feeder when you leave for vacation, and the fish are already accustomed to eating it. And as I mentioned earlier, you want to consistently feed those fish, because stable nutrients in your system are just going to make everything better. So make sure you're using those high quality phosphate and nitrate kits, keeping tabs on how things are changing and trends in your tank. And number eight, hair algae. Yeah, I know how much we love this stuff, but here's what I do at first sign of it. Number one, manual removal. Number two, reduce feeding to encourage tanks to eat the algae. Number three, check the PO4 and replace GFO if necessary. Number four, check RODI filters. Five, inspect tank for anything that may have died. Six, increase the light duration in the algae scrubber. Seven, large water change 40% 2 times back to back over 2 weeks. And number eight, if it's hair algae or bryopsis, I'll treat with fluconazole, and you can see a video about that in the description. And here's one that crept up on me recently. A good friend and talented reefer, reefing underscore Carlos on Instagram, pointed out to me that my specific gravity had fallen to a level that was noticeably low. This probably had to do with a lot of things. Water changes, the dosing, two-part dosing that I do. Pretty much anything you do with the reef can affect your specific gravity level. Since everything in our aquariums revolves around our salinity level, it's probably smart to test it in a variety of ways to not just rely on one device. So here I'm using a hydrometer, and these can be a little tricky because you have to make sure all the air bubbles are knocked off that little swinging arm. I have this ice cap conductivity tester, which is not very accurate, but it's consistent in its inaccuracy. This is an older unit that is not calibratable. The new ones are. But with that said, I was just gifted a Hanna salinity tester by Carlos, which I'll be employing soon since the ice probe is 5 points off. If you aren't already using this device to measure salinity, you should head to your local fish store and grab one today. It's a reefing refractometer that utilizes refracted light to determine the amount of dissolved salts in a solution, and once calibrated properly with RODI, it is very accurate. My thought is, with these devices that are so critical, so important to the health of your fish and coral, you're going to want all three to check against each other, especially because these are devices that need to be calibrated. If one goes bad, you don't want to be left guessing. And make sure to rinse them off, take really good care of them, as these are precision instruments that, if not cared for properly, will give you inaccurate results. Whether you love or hate spiders, you most likely, if a reefer, do not want zoanthid-eating spiders in your system. Really, this is about all coral-munching pests, such as flatworms, red bugs, whatever, you name it. You do not want them getting into your tank. I have been very careful to not introduce these pests into my system, but I have seen what they do to other people's tanks, and believe me, they wreak serious havoc. While it is true that introducing certain predators, such as cleaner shrimp, peppermint shrimp, certain types of wrasses can really help with an infestation, the best thing to do is to put your new introductions through quarantine and treat them with something you trust. I treat everything that goes into my tank with Tropic Marin Pro Coral Cure. I've had good luck with it. It's mainly iodine, I believe. Don't quote me on that, but it works. I treat everything that goes into the tank twice. I do one dip, 15 minutes, rinse it off, move it around, make sure, shake everything off that coral, make sure there's nothing on it, put it into quarantine, observe it, rinse and repeat. Basically going to do this for 2 months, observe the coral, not even think about putting into the main display or even my main frag tank until everything has been treated and tested. If you are new to the hobby, take the word of all the reefing veterans who've been burned by pests in the past. Treat everything that goes in, make sure it's quarantined before you introduce it to your system, and your tank will treat you well. Folks, that is it for this video. It was a lot of fun to make. I hope you liked it as well. Hit the thumbs up, subscribe, leave a comment below. It motivates us to make more videos. I'm going to leave you with this jack-o'-lantern Leptoceras and my son making spooky ghost noises.